with the movie that we have mentioned briefly in one of our earlier chats, Crumb. And the song is Geechee Wiley's Last Kind Word Blues. Terry Zwigoff is the director, 1994. Great movie. Love the scene. Completely love the scene.
Funny, somebody just and I was trying to describe that woman to you, the woman on Facebook who everybody knows in Toronto. It's Irrelevant.
Right. Or Relevant, yes.
Irrelevant. She goes by her real name on Facebook. Right. She posted a picture of Robert Crumb today and it was like amazing. He has aged so much since that film. I mean, he was pretty old when they made Crumb, right?
Yeah.
And that's now 25 years ago?
Yeah, 25 years ago, yeah.
So he's old now. He's gotta be in his 80s. Yeah, you know, I should have looked at that scene again before thinking that we're going to be talking about it tonight. What I remember is that it's around the time in the film where they're going to move his record collection. He's talking about his 78s. And he just leans back. I think Marcus describes the scene very well. He just leans back. And is it Geechee Wiley? Is that her name?
Yeah, yeah. I don't know if it's pronounced Geechee or Geechee, and I've seen it spelled differently too. So
that song starts playing, and it's just this mournful. It's not even country blues, is it? It's sort of a Harry Smith type song.
Yeah, it's hard to describe the genre. I mean, it probably would be classified as a blues song, but yeah.
No, I said it's not country. It's not that sort of. That really melodic country blues, number 100 you posted when we did the.
Yeah, I know it's probably a little close even to Robert Johnson or something.
It's like more that. Like a Robert Johnson song, yeah. And he just leans back, and I think he closes his eyes, and he just loses himself in this song. But either before or just after or during in voiceover, he starts talking about how when he listens to music like that. He says something like, it's the only time, I think that's the quote, it's the only time he connects with the soul of mankind. He says it really kind of wryly, sardonically in the film. And it's the only time he feels like this love of mankind, right?
Yeah.
And it's just such a spooky scene, and it clearly ties in with the later scene, the later Terry Zwigoff scene in Ghost World, where she's listening to Skip James, not Elmore James, Skip James.
And Devil Got My Woman or something.
Devil
like that,
Got My Woman, yeah.
Yeah.
And you know, I can't. It's the same filmmaker. So, you know, if it were another filmmaker, you'd say clearly he was thinking of the Crumb scene when he directed that, but it's the same filmmaker. I guess maybe he just wanted to take that scene and put it in a narrative context because those scenes go hand in hand.
Yeah, yeah.
And as we talked about last time, that's the earliest song on the list. It's the one song that, you know, by no stretch of the imagination links with modern day pop. Well, no, that's not right. It does link with it, but it's clearly off in a different world, right?
Right.
Like you pointed out to me about Last Picture Show, the Hank Williams stuff, to me that would fit in too. Had I chosen that, I wouldn't hesitate to include that.
Mm-hmm.
But, and then we talked about stuff that doesn't really seem to fit.
Yeah, yeah.
Somehow that seems to fit. It really does.
And is the Geechee Wiley, would the movie have turned you into a fan of the song, or does it live in the movie for you?
It lives in the movie. Like right now, I couldn't hum the song to you. If somebody played it, I think I would probably say, oh yeah, that's the song from Crumb.
Yeah.
My mama told me just before she died, Lord, said, daughter, don't you be the one. The Mississippi River, you know it, she's wide. I can't stand right here, be my babe from the other side. What you do to me, baby, it never gets out of me. I may not see after I close the door.
Does he ever talk, like, I know he, you know, he talks, I think, about sort of the hippies and stuff, and he felt very, even though he was part of that scene for various reasons, and he liked the free love aspect of it and all that, but he didn't care for the hippies, and I presume he never cared for any of the music. Does he say at one point even that he didn't even care for the music, or did he like Janis Joplin or anything, I wonder?
He certainly, he is so... derisive, he just ridicules.
Yeah.
I mean, a big part of his problem, I don't know if he ever liked the music, but I think he hates it all now because he tells the story. He never got it. They used his cover. He designed the cover for Cheap Thrills.
Right.
I think he got some nominal payment, never got paid again.
Mm.
That was the number one album, and it made a lot, not even for the band. I don't even think it made that much money for the band. It made a lot of money for the record company.
Yeah.
And the other thing he talks about is the keep on trucking symbol.
Right.
Where they used his guy.
Yeah.
Supernatural, I think. And that,
yep.
That iconic image. People made millions of dollars at the time. There was this guy in Toronto, Crazy David's t-shirts. We probably talked about this at one point. That was his signature t-shirt from Crazy David. He never saw any of that money. So he talks in the film how he just, if anybody comes up to him in a comic book store or something, just keep on trucking.
Yeah.
he just automatically just channels and zeros every last bit of hate he has towards him. He hates it because he never made any money from either of them. I don't know what the standing of that film is today. I mean, that is such a key film for me because... you know, I went through this whole decade and a half, or I mean, it never ended. It kind of subsided a bit, but where I just became, I watched so many documentaries, and it really does start with that film.
Yeah, I remember that. This was the first one really that kicked it off.
Yeah, there were at least a couple. There were prominent. It was already happening. I mean, you could say the first documentary really could just. I'll keep this short, but the first one that really caught my attention was the Chet Baker one, Let's Get Lost.
Right.
The first, I think, and then you had Michael Moore did Roger and Me, and then a big
basketball thing, one too, right?
I was just going to say the big thing before Crumb was in '92. I think 2 years earlier, you had Hoop Dreams.
Hoop Dreams, thank you.
Which Ebert worked so hard to promote. It should have won the Academy Award. It wasn't even nominated for that committee. It used to have just crazy rules. And I saw and liked to one degree or another. I really liked Let's Get Lost. Hoop Dreams, I've appreciated, I've come to love more as I watch it more. Anyway, Crumb, though, for me, was the beginning of all that. And it was a very acclaimed film. And I don't know if it's, I should check that list of 1,000 films online to see if it's in there.
Yeah, you don't really hear anything about it.
And no.
Certainly, Crumb and his art and stuff is not very in step with what people... what a lot of people will stomach at a movie nowadays. Unfortunately, because to me it's a valuable slice of time, if nothing else. You don't have to be admiring of it or something. I think all that stuff is just so interesting, though. Like his, you know.
That's the other thing. I mean, that was even an issue in the film, right?
Oh, I know.
Because you've got Robert Hughes defending him, and I'll never forget, he's so good in that film because it's just the way he says it. He just spits out that line about something about the Berkeley Board of Directors. Crumb was already, and I wouldn't even doubt, going almost back to the 70s. I mean, he is, for obvious reasons, he has been a villain for the feminist movement.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that issue. He left the country, moved to France, you know, that diminishes it too. And the other thing I was going to say, Terry Zwigoff, he's gone on to have an interesting career. Ghost World was, I think, by any standard, a success critically in every way. It's been pretty dicey since then.
Mm.
and sometimes he made films I didn't even know they were him, like that film Bad Santa with Billy Bob Thornton. I didn't find out till 10 years later that he directed that, and I still haven't seen it.
It's good. I liked it, actually. You can tell it's a Terry Zwigoff film.
Okay, I've been meaning to see it. The one that I did see was one of his follow-ups. It didn't get a lot of acclaim, but I do like it. It's called Art School Confidential.
Oh, I like that. I think I saw that with you, actually. I think we saw
could have
together,
seen it
actually.
Together.
Was that who's the actress in that again? The main actor?
Oh, well, the main actor is not that well known. It's Max somebody. I can picture him, Max Miguel or something.
Who's the woman, though? I'm trying to think.
No, I know you're right. The art teacher is a well known actress, and I'm blanking.
So I know we're talking about the same movie, and I'm certain I saw that with you, actually. And I think we both did like it at the time. So
it was pretty good. It wasn't as good as Ghost World. And then I think he went back and did some TV. I'll check tonight, but he never really, and you know, that not like it's not a surprise. I mean, clearly he was friends with Crumb, and he's probably kind of a morose guy himself. I don't think he was exactly cut out to be, you know, directing Mission Impossible type things. Yeah. Guys like that often do find a home on TV. Mm. I don't know how active he is right now.
Yeah.
I wish I could think of that actress's name from Art School.
I know, I could, like, I've seen her and stuff. Her face is so familiar. I don't know why I just can't.
It wasn't Holly.